Welcome you all once again to this follow-up lecture on blast furnace iron making. I think yesterday, in the previous lecture, we have seen the reactions, phase changes that has occurred in stack region, that is the shaft part of the blast furnace. Basically, the reactions involved gas solid reactions, whatever involved at a different region of the shaft that been discussed yesterday. So we are just slowly moving inside or more deep into the blast furnace. Possibly today we will discuss about coercive zones and active coke zone, tear zone. These three I have prepared. So I think these three are most important region in the blast furnace, which dictates quality of hot metal production, many things. It depends on all these zones actually only. As far as whatever we have seen, that is restricted only to the shaft part. In the shaft part, almost 95%, of course, you can call even 100% of the materials are still in solid state only. So there is no any melting. As I already told, it is very specific to ideal blast furnace condition. However, in the operating conditions, you can expect some meltings that can begin in the early stage of shaft itself. So we restrict our discussion to only the ideal blast furnace. Okay, so today also I would like to start with these general facts, what I have shown yesterday. There is one minor change I have changed in those facts. I think you could be able to see that I have added solid and liquids, okay, because you are going to see liquids. The liquids are going to form in the blast furnace. So the no more only solid and the gases, that is not practical, because there are some liquids are going to form. So the liquids will come into coexistence with the gaseous part. Okay, so that's the only change. The remaining things will be same as yesterday we discussed. So with this we will move to today's subject or today's part of discussion. Okay. I think before we to discuss very specific to the zones, we'll first let's understand what is this softening mechanism, how the iron oxide or the lump iron ore, whatever we have charged into the blast furnace, that is getting softening, and ultimately that is going to going to be a state of molten state. That how that is happening, that's we are going to see. Okay, just to follow the figures, whatever it is given in the slides, you can see these are all the lump iron ore, and you can see there are two different colors. The yellow color represent the product or the product that formed due to the gaseous reduction, gas solid reduction process that been carried in the shaft region. So you can expect these yellow regions are almost close to iron, or some part maybe FeO. Okay, mostly iron. Almost it got metallized. This region is metallized. It is given yellow color for the understanding. In the zone below, I think below the lower shaft, what we are referring, the temperature is already I have mentioned 1300 and kind of above. Okay. So the red hot or the appearance of the iron in that temperature may be of yellow color. In that perspective, it has been given yellow color. Okay. The inside part, there is a small black color is given. That is nothing but the left out iron ore or the core that is getting shrink. As we already mentioned, that the shrinking core model applicable for blast furnace iron ore reduction. So this is a one lump which is having a reduced part in the periphery, and the core is left out with a part of unreduced ore. So that is a thing which is coming down into the lower part of the shaft. And of course you can imagine maybe 50 to 70 meter or even more than a height of burden materials are lying above that partly reduced iron ore lumps. Whenever you refer to your location, that is in the lower shaft, you have a huge amount of materials or basically stack up, okay, because you are continuously charging. So it is not like a batch process. You charge it and then you completely remove it and then you charge it to completely remove. That is not happening. There is a simultaneous tapping is also happening and you are also charging from the top. So the lumps that being present in the lower stack region will experience a huge amount of burden load, whichever present above that material. That causes, you know, basically a deformation of these lumps. You can see the elliptical changes in the shape, elliptical nature. So that is completely due to the temperature is sufficient enough that can deform the iron ore lumps. It is no more called iron ore lumps. It is, you can call it as a composite, kind of composite material. The outer part is a metallic and the inner part is a kind of complex oxides. Okay. And further, going down or increasing the temperature, either way you can take it, either by going down into the blast furnace or increasing the temperature. You can see that the inside material, you know, whatever I am telling about that, what do you call, unreduced part, the left out iron ore content, which consists of FeO because that is not being reduced properly, and also it, the iron ore have lot of gang material. The example is one is the SiO2, Al2O3. This kind of gang material is already present in the iron ore. So what happens, this FeO will react with, or it will fluxes with the gang material and it forms phyllite, FeO-SiO2 or FeO-SiO2-Al2O3 kind of complex oxides. These complex oxides have melting temperature lesser than the melting point of iron. So the periphery will be unmelted and the core which have FeO will mingle with SiO2 and Al2O3 and it will tend to melt. And the liquid is now, the molten liquid is present in the core. And further increasing the temperature along with the simultaneous increase in the load of the burden material lying above. If the material travels further inside, it will experience more load and the hydrostatic pressure, that you know, the hydrostatic pressure that being exerted by the liquid in the core will try to exceed, right? Because you are trying to squeeze, and the liquid, you know, liquid is one thing, you cannot it cannot be kind of compressible. It will try to squeeze out, it will try to ooze out from the cracks or the voids or any other defects that whichever present along the which connects the external surface of the lump to the inside core of that unreduced part. So the liquid will try to come out, and first what it will do, it will fill. That's what it's shown in this figure. Here the liquid is completely the part is completely converted to liquid except the periphery, and here you can see the liquids are oozing out from the cracks, whatever it present, and finally what it will do, it will fill up the voids between the particles. And then ultimately it will cover the unreduced or the complete lumps. Whatever the iron is there, periphery, everything will get covered by the liquid, whatever it is coming down. So this is the direction the material is moving inside, or you can assume this is the direction the temperature is increasing, and this is the phenomena that is happening because of the pressure and the temperature that experiences. Okay. So this is the way that the softening of the iron oxide or the lump is happening inside the blast furnace. Okay, so you can see there are different academically it have been described in different stages. The first stage is called reduction retardation stage. Why it is a reduction retardation means the reduction is actually stopping there, because the gases will penetrate into the core through the periphery where the iron oxide, solid iron, is there. The gases can easily go inside because it is a solid. But when it, as soon as meet the liquid inside that lump, that the core part is liquid, the reduction will stop, because the gas liquid reaction, you know, the resistance is more. The gas liquid reduction will not take place that much. So that it have been called as reduction retardation stage. So that the differential resistance for the reduction reaction is being coming into the picture because of the presence of core liquid and the periphery solid. So that is the one thing. So the reduction retardation stage may be the initial first two figures, And there is an exudation stage. As I already told, the temperature is increasing and the load is increasing, the hydrostatic pressure is building up. So the liquid is trying to coming out. So and the liquid is completely filling the voids. When the voids are getting filled by the liquid which is coming out from the lump, there is no more any voids or no more any gaps are present for the gases to pass through. Basically, our objective is that the gases need to pass through the burden material and then only it can meet the upper stack. So these are all the stages where the pressure drop will be very high because there are a lot of resistance is offered by the liquids, whatever it is formed. So the pressure drop increases. The locally, this is not a bulk pressure drop of the furnace. It is actually a local pressure drop which is creating. As soon as the pressure is building up, that the pressure means in the sense I am telling about the blast pressure is building, then it will try to find some ways so that the gases can move upwards. Okay, so that's the exudation stage where the tremendous amount of pressure drops occurs due to filling up of voids by the liquids that is coming out from the lungs. And finally, the melting stage. These are all, you know, softened, you can say, kind of softened liquids, that is the pasty kind of, like the paste, what we are daily, we are using paste, you know. It's not completely liquid, but it have capacity to fill the voids sometimes. Even if you add a few more liquids or make a liquid form, that can fill the voids. But it may not be completely liquid. As this format of lumps, when it is getting down, then finally the temperature is increasing. And the temperature of the liquid also will get increased and the melting starts. This is the time or the region with respect to the location, you can say that the melting of iron oxide or the burden material begins. Basically, the melting point of iron also would have reached at that point. So the periphery already which was in the solid state, that will get melt. And the core which consists of iron oxide and the gangue material, that will also get melt in the form of slag. So the drippings, the slag dripping and the liquid molten iron dripping, that will begins in that stage. The slag, it will start to drip out the liquids, whichever is getting formed in that time. Okay. By dripping out, the vacancies are created, the vacancy means the holes are created and the gases will try way to move upward. Okay, so this is the overall phenomena that is occurring in pertaining to softening and melting of the iron oxide, and there will be continuous dripping. Molten liquids drops will form continuously, and the layer will get replenished at every moment, and there will be a new voids will be forming, vacant spaces the gases can form, and the gases will penetrate, and then it will go to the upper stack. Okay, so that's the concept here. You can say that it's a moment where the dripping begins. Okay, so this whole phenomena, starting from this to the dripping, that basically, you know, this phenomena, it is occur in a as shown in the previous figure, it occur in a fashion of inverted U shape. It have its own width, means the softening begins at one stage, that is called the cohesive zone starting point, and when the liquids are dripping, that is called the point where the cohesive zone ends. So this particularly, this width, that width of the cohesive zone is dictated by this extent of this mechanisms. How far, what is the softening temperature of a burden material and what is the melting point of the burden material. This temperature gap basically dictates your cohesive zone width and the shape of the cohesive zone, whether it is a U or V, inverted U or W, M, everything is possible. That is based on spring principle. It is controlled by the furnace operating parameters. Okay. So you can see that cohesive zone which have a layered structure of burden material so far in the upper stack, and when it enter into the cohesive zone, initially the fusion will take place and cohesion will take place and followed by melting. So this is just the whole phenomena have been put up here in the three words. This fusion to melting, the time or the spatial requirement may be called as a width of the cohesive zone. How long it will take? What is the temperature requirement? The temperature difference of the burden material, the corresponding temperatures like softening temperature and the melting temperature, and that dictates the width of your cohesive zone. And the important things you have to note here is the location of cohesive zone, shape of cohesive zone, and the size of cohesive zone. This cohesive zone, as in our previous figure, what we showed is the inverted U. This basically will act as a gas distributor that will distribute gas evenly to the stack part. Okay, in two dimension, it looks like a inverted U, but in an actual furnace, in an ideal blast furnace, if you see, the cohesive zone will look like a dome. Okay, it will be like this. Maybe you can see it in the video. It will be like a dome where the gases will move here, and it will be getting evenly distributed from the dome to the upper stack. Okay, this distribution is primarily controlled by whatever the mechanisms I told earlier, the resistance offered by the melting and filling of the voids and final dripping out, which create basically the create space for the gases to percolate into the shaft zone. Okay, you can see just a pictorial view, it is given. Okay, you can see that dome like appearance, and the gases are just going here and there and getting distributed. Okay, in a very close one part of the side is shown here. You can see the gases, or this is the cohesive zone, and you can see this is the width. It starts from here and it is ending here, and wherever the gases finding the path, it is basically traveling. These are all the region where the solid materials are and the layered structure of burden material, that is basically maintaining that burden arrangements. Okay, now let's come to the shape. One is a W shape and another is a inverted U shape. And these two are the famous, most familiar shapes of the cohesive zone. You can see the W shape will come when the productivity is lesser in that case. Basically, it is given wrong. And for the inverted V shape, the productivity is high. Means your raceways or raceway or the raceway that blast, when you are driving your furnace very fast, very hard, when you are injecting more amount of blast and you are creating more temperature, then all the tuyeres will collectively will meet at a point, and then it will create a space like this, and then you will get a inverted V. But when you are the length of your raceway, we will see in the further slides, when it is less, then it create a W kind of shape, where the lower crocrete, the crocrete that is LCR, it is given, the crocrete is low. And in case of V shape, you are driving hard, basically. You are trying to extract more hot metal. Then in that case, the crocrete is very high. What are all the factors basically dictating this shape? One is the burden distribution. This is very well known. Burden distribution is the most important parameter which control the cohesive zone properties and the other phenomena related to that. And another is a burden descending mechanism. If there are any blockages, scaffolding, any irregularities that occurring in the stack zone. Suppose, as we yesterday we discussed that cycle, alkali cycle. If that sort of cycle creates some local irregularities in the stack movement, the burden material movement, then the cohesive zone will get affected. The shape of the cohesive zone will get affected, and the reducibility, as we already discussed in the mechanism of the softening, that the outer part is already reduced to iron. And the inside part is basically FeO and gangue material. So the reducibility factor comes into picture. You want to, as we already discussed, you want to encourage more amount of indirect reduction. It means that the periphery part, that the iron reduction reduced part, has to be more. If you have very minor amount of iron, metallized iron in the periphery, then your cohesive zone width will be very high. And also, that the cohesive zone shape also will get changed in that way. And the near tuyere characteristics that I shown, if you want to inject more amount of gases with a huge volume and the pressure, then that is a major parameter which basically affect your shape of the cohesive zone. And feed characteristics like pulverized coal injections, humidification, These are all things we will see in the further slides. Okay. And coming to the location, basically where the location, this also we already told that the lower part of the shaft, that too in the lower part of the shaft, that too in the center portion, you may have some amount of corrosive zone because of this inverted U shape, and remaining will be in the belly. Okay. So there is also a possibility this corrosive zone can be shifted upwards and it can be shifted downwards based on the operating parameters. Okay. When you try to drive the furnace very hard, when you inject more amount of blast, when you are creating a very high temperature, other than means in comparison to the normal operating temperature, then you are basically moving your corrosive zone upwards. You want corrosive zone to be formed lower to the lower stack region, shaft region. Otherwise, what it had happened, as we told yesterday, the thermal reserve zone and the chemical reserve zone will get affected. That has to be a maximum part. If you are hijacking some amount of portion in the thermal reserve zone and the chemical reserve zone, obviously your proportion of indirect reduction will get reduced. So that's the principle here. If the location goes higher, means to the higher portion of the stack, then indirect reduction will get reduces and the pressure drop reduces. When the corrosive zone is moving downwards, if you are not sufficiently injecting blast, if you are not sufficient, the pressure of the blast is not sufficient enough, then what happens? The localized temperature will be less, and the corrosive zones will be lying in the lower zone where the pressure drop will be very high. The resistance offered will be very high because just below to the corrosive zone, what you have inside the blast furnace is nothing but liquid and coke. Okay, so then the resistance will be huge. So the pressure drop will be very high because the liquids already, I told, the liquid started forming. Every material, all burden material except coke, everything will be in the liquid state. Okay, and finally, let us discuss that the size of the corrosive zone. That's what I told, the width portion of the corrosive zone. This width portion completely depends upon the raw material characteristics. The characteristics temperatures, where is the what is the softening temperature, what is the melting temperature. This temperature difference will dictate your width of your corrosive zone. Okay, if it is thicker, basically if you have a huge difference, suppose 150, 200, 250 degrees Celsius difference of these characteristic temperature, then the width of the corrosive zone will be very high. And in that case, the pressure drop will be very high because the resistance offered will be very high. It is simple because the time it is taking for softening to complete melting, it is taking huge time. So that the resistance offered will be proportionally high, the pressure drop will be again proportionally high. So that's what the raw material engineering, like sintering, acidic sinter, basic sinter, superflux sinter, there are different categories of sinters of their qualities you can produce, and pellets, different type of pellets are also there, and different raw material will behave differentially here based on the physicochemical nature of the compositions, whatever it is there. So that's why a right selection of raw material and right combination of different raw material will basically decide what is your corrosive zone size and its location and its shape in an operating blast furnace. Okay. So we can comfortably here, we can conclude that from the corrosive zone, what all you are getting? One is a liquid slag and another is a liquid metal, that is a molten metal, and another is a solid coke. Please remember, the coke is still solid. This is the most peculiar nature of this coke. Here we are not calling it as a coal or charcoal or nothing, but that is the reason coke is playing an important role in blast furnace iron making. This you cannot expect from other raw material. The same amount of load, whatever experienced by the burden material, other burden material, iron ore, lime and everything, is being experienced by coke, and still it withstand its solid nature, and the solidity is still it have. That's where the importance of coke is coming. It is not only a simply a reductant, it is also a material which withstand that thermal and also the load, kind of load, whatever it is going to experience in that you just think it's a meter of more than 70 meter height is there for a bigger blast furnace. You can think that much amount of material is just lying above that cohesive zone, and below there is a coke is there. So it is not crushing basically. It is not the solid part is just a minute. Sir, online lecture. Complete ma'am. Sorry. Okay, so that's the peculiar part of this coke is coming here. The one is the strength that is going to withstand, and another is a reductant. So this combination hardly exists in other reductants. Okay. And now let us see. Now we are coming down to the cohesive zone. What we going to see is an active coke zone. It is nothing but a kind of coke heap, basically. A coke heap is placed over there because it is coming down, and the coke heap is immersed in molten liquids, maybe slag, and the iron is there. This is none other than the charged coke, which is basically descending down, and unburned coke particles, maybe, because we are going to see just in another couple of slides the raceway zone, where the coke is getting consumed or it is getting burned. So the remaining coke is just deposited just aside this raceway zone from the bottom of the heart, and that makes to be a coke zone, active coke zone. You can see, yeah, as I already told that unimaginable role of coke in blast furnace is that is a part. It have to withstand the huge load and also the temperature, and also it acts as a heat source, also the reductant. Okay, this is basically the active coke zone consists of small and medium sized coke, right? It may not have the same size what you have charged, but its size could have been reduced due to, of course, there can be degradation and there can be consumption from raceway path, so the size could have get reduced. And it acts as a percolator. That's what I'm telling, that the liquids, the slags, FeO, SiO2, Al2O3 mixture of complex slags and also the molten metal, that needs to percolate through the active coke zone. Okay, there is no other way because it is completely a block. It is a completely packed portion. There are no any runway kind of in foundries you can see where the liquids can easily flow. Not that kind of scenario is happening there. It have to percolate through the coke zone. Okay, and where while it is percolating through the coke particles, the materials whatever it is there, the compositional adjustment between the slag, metal and the coke is happening. The iron, molten iron will take carbon. That is the carburizing part. That's the way you are ending up with a significant amount of carbon in the molten pig iron, and the temperature is sufficient enough. It will be highly responsive to capture carbon from the coke zone, and the slag is there. And the slag which have FeO, so there you can expect the same similar kind of direct reduction. It is a liquid solid reduction. FeO liquid plus carbon solid reduction, Fe plus CO. So that reduction is there, where unnecessary consumption of carbon is also taking place there, because as we already told, indirect reduction has to be in a bigger way for an efficient blast furnace. Okay, and of course the whole structure of the blast furnace, in the sense the huge height that we are it is lying above, it is basically supported by this active coke zone and the cohesive zone. If you have anywhere damages in this cohesive zone because of some local irregularities, there can be a slipping of materials from the top. Mass material that can be suddenly dropped into the lower zone. This kind of irregularities can be happened over there. So the major role is being played by the cohesive zone and the active coke zone, which basically maintain the blast furnace structure. Okay. And these are all the reactions. FeO can get reduced. FeO present as ferrite also, and calcium ferrite also. Calcium ferrite is a kind of complex oxide that generates when you use basic flux or kind of super flux, the basicity when it is higher than 2 when you have added lime in the sintering process itself, then that will cause calcium ferrite, which will get reduced here. And carburization, that I told, hot metal will take carbon here, and pronounced CO2 plus C gives 2CO reaction. Okay, because the CO2 is coming. CO2 is again supplied by the raceway. Raceway is going to supply a huge amount of gas, and that CO2 will react with the C, and it will take, it will consume energy. It is an endothermic reaction, and it will generate CO. And this CO is basically the reducing CO, which is going to pass through the shaft region for indirect reduction. Okay, and sulfur and silicon transfer will occur. Sulfur and silicon transfer, we will deal it in next class, because that is most important part of the blast furnace to control the quality. So dedicated lecture is there for sulfur and silicon transfer, that we will take next class. Okay, and reduction of other oxides. The temperature is very high here, 1700, more than that, because the blast, because you are just near to the tuer zone. The tuer is experiencing 2000 degrees Celsius, so you can expect the active coke zone would be in the temperature of 1700 to 1800. These temperatures are sufficient enough to reduce P2O5, Cr2O3, SiO2. All whatever the gang materials are present, that will get reduced here. Just to cross check the Ellingham diagram, you can check the reducing temperature for all these oxides, and most of the silicon, manganese oxides, everything will get reduced by coke, and everything will form into the hot metal. Okay, that's the reason P2O5 phosphorus is reporting completely to the metal phase. Whatever the phosphorus is present in the burden material will get completely reduced, and then it will join metal phase. Okay, and similar to silicon. Silicon is not completely, there is some amount of silicon will report in the slag, and silicon, because the reducing temperature for the silicon is silica is high, is comparatively higher than other oxides, so there is a competition where it will go, whether it will go to silicon slag or metal. These things will deal in the silicon transfer reaction. Okay, and it's just a pictorial view how this active zones will look like. Okay, this is the raceway, we have not touched yet that raceway, we'll deal that. And you can see that that's going to be the coccusive zone. You can see which shows the width of the coccusive zone and the shape of the coccusive zone. And this is going to be a active coke zone where the unconsumed coke particles, which is coming from the top, is getting accumulated over there. And the liquids are, this is the gases that are passing through the active coke zone and also through the coccusive zone, and it is getting away from coccusive zone and meeting the shaft path, and you can see the drippings. So it's just a small animation, just to for a better understanding what are all the phenomena it is happening, how it is happening. Okay, now let's come to the tuer zone. Tuer zone is another most important part in the blast furnace. This is just a physical arrangement, a tube kind of thing. Through which you will inject oxygen. Okay, a blast, hot blast you are injecting. Along with the hot blast, you are also injecting some amount of additional reductant like pulverized coal, a coal dust you are also injecting. It is just to meet, you know, to reduce the coke rate. Instead of supplying coke from there, carbon from top, you are giving some amount of carbon through the tuers, so that the coke rate can be reduced. The coke is an imported material for India. Almost most of the steel plants, not every steel plant, is importing coke from Australia. Okay, so it is the costliest raw material that we are using in the blast furnace. So it is always the thrust is to reduce the coke rate in blast furnace iron making. So there are several developments that have been undertaken. The one is the pulverized coal injection through tuers. So you are just replacing some amount of carbon source through the tuer, and the blast will be injected in a very high velocity. Okay, 200 to 300 meter per second, the velocity of the thing. Just think, 200 to 300 meter per second, you are injecting gas, and inside the blast furnace, it is highly packed. Okay, it is very tightly packed. Coal particles are deposited here and there, and you are just pushing that much amount of blast with the velocity 200 to 300 meter per second. What it will create? It will create a tremendous impact on the coke particles, the lying particle, and it will create a vacant space near to the tuer entry, and this that space will be adjusted based on the other parameters of the tear injection, okay, and it will push away the particles, coke particles, whatever lying near to the tear zone, and it will create a basically a vacant space where it can the reactions of the tear zones will occur. This is only because you are injecting it with a very high velocity. It is again an unimaginable part. It is a tightly packed inside the reactor is inside, it is having like that, and you are injecting hot blast in a very high velocity. Okay, this cavity, whatever the cavity that being generated because of this injection, all sort of reaction, the combustion reaction, we call it as a combustion reaction, because you are injecting oxygen and the atmosphere is completely carbon, it is completely covered by carbon, so oxygen is there, carbon is there, so readily it will combust. Okay, the combustion reaction will take place in the cavity what it have been generated. Okay, this combusted atmosphere is the part what we call it as a raceway, and it looks like you know kind of a balloon that been blown like that. It shown in the slide, right? So in that way it will create a space, and then the shape will looks like this. Okay, what are all the combustion reactions you can expect? The first and foremost is carbon will react with oxygen, and then it will form CO2, and some amount of energy will be not some amount, a huge amount of energy will be released, because this is an oxidation reaction. C plus O2 gives CO2. Okay, and the gas what you are injecting via tears, that since it is coming in a very high velocity, it will carry away some of the coal particles from the active coke zone, because it will just first go and hit, and then it will just drag some fine particles from the active coke zone, and that coke will be encouraged for carbon oxidation reaction. Apart from the carbon what you are injecting in terms of pulverized coal injection, okay, so see, this raceway will have part amount is an oxidation atmosphere and part amount is a reducing atmosphere. It means till to this portion the composition mixture of the oxidation, the gases, what it would be carbon plus oxygen and then carbon dioxide. So it will be completely carbon dioxide in this zone, which we call it as an oxidation zone, oxidizing zone of raceway. And away from that oxidizing zone, the CO2, the generated CO2 will again react with the carbon particles, whatever dragged into the raceway, and the CO2 plus C gives 2CO, that reaction will occur, and again it converted to reducing zone. How we are naming this? Simple, the CO2 is an oxidizing gas, right, and CO is a reducing gas. Okay, so if you plot the profile of this gas composition, the oxygen will decrease from the tear entry to that full raceway cover, it will decrease, the oxygen partial pressure will decrease, and the carbon dioxide, it will increase to some extent and then it will decrease, and that particular point where the carbon dioxide partial pressure is decreasing, there the carbon monoxide will increase. So wherever the carbon monoxide is there, that part is a reducing zone, and wherever the carbon dioxide is high, that part is called as oxidizing zone. Okay, so basically this is the molten material, the burden materials other than coke, everything got molten, and then it is dripping, and then it is getting collected in the heart. This is well understood, and this is the zone where the charged coke is getting consumed. Practically, in physical point of view, the consumption of coke is actually taking place in this zone. Okay, that's the reason you also need to charge along with the raw materials consistently. You have to other raw materials consistently. You have to charge coke also for the thermal demand and also for the chemical demand, for the reduction, for generation of CO, everything. Okay, whichever coke is not getting consumed in this combustion reaction, that get deposited and it has formed the active coke zone, which we have seen earlier. Okay, the active coke zones are the material that being dumped. Those materials are practically have not taken place in the combustion reactions. So those were pushed and then those were accumulated and then they have formed a coke zone. Okay. This flame, this is basically a flame, na? Right? The carbon and oxygen is reacting and that is nothing but a flame. Okay, like a candle or any lamp wherever you are lighting, what you are seeing is a flame. A kind of flame is that also. But the flame property is completely different. The velocity is different, velocity is huge and the numbers are very huge and the composition of the flame within the flame is different, like oxidizing zone and reducing zone, all these things are there. So whatever oxygen you are injecting, it is completely getting meeting some carbon particles and then the oxygen is completely vanished there, or the complete oxygen whatever you are injecting is getting consumed for consumption reaction. So and these combustion reactions will create some energy, will release some energy, and that energy is completely involved for heating up the combustion product mixture like the CO2. Okay, so that the energy is not going somewhere outside the flame. This energy is completely involved for heating that product mixture, the gas product mixture, which is nothing but CO2. So it is called, it is being called as RAFT, raceway adiabatic flame temperature. Okay, that temperature, that characteristic temperature what we are going to refer is on and around, you can keep it is 2000 degrees Celsius for any normal blast furnace. Sometimes it can be higher than also. As I told, the operating blast furnaces will have altogether a different numbers based on the strategy what they are, the way they are operating. Okay, so that's why it is called raceway adiabatic flame temperature. Whatever the heat it is released, the energy that is released being consumed for is involved in heating up the gas mixture. Okay, that's the part adiabatic is coming here. Okay, and then this CO2 mixture is passing through the active coke zone, coke zone, and then shaft. Okay, for other reactions. And as this raceway, if it have depth of penetration, the depth of penetration in the sense the length of the raceway. If the length of the raceway is higher, if it penetrates more into the blast furnace or the depth is very high, then you can expect inverted U shape. And this depth of penetration is depend upon the your operating characteristics. Okay, the velocity, the volumetric flow rate, temperature of the blast, everything will dictate at what extent the flame is going. If lower the penetration, then you can expect M-type coercive zone. Okay, now you can understand, you can relate it with how this coercive zone shape is getting changed with different various operating parameters. Okay, you see what are all the parameters or the factors that affects the blast parameters: volumetric flow rate, temperature and pressure, and the diameter and the length of the tuer. If the length of the tuer is high, then there is a probability that you can penetrate deeper. Okay, and inter tuer space, that is one another thing which is involving in controlling the coercive zone, because it is a Bessel pipe which is surrounded outside, and these Bessel pipe tuers are being taken. Okay, with an equal intervals, maybe a bigger blast furnace would expect to have some 30 to 35 number of tuers with even interval of distance, spatial distance, the tuers are projected into the blast furnace. This inter tuer space also it decides. Okay, because when you have a close inter tuer space, what you can expect, the raceway that being coming from both the tuers can meet at some point and then it can mingle. You may not expect some solid region where the liquids can percolate, or the maximum volume of the furnace can be will be used only for this raceway. Okay, you also need to accommodate the liquids that is being generated there. Okay, so that inter tuer space has to be judiciously selected so that the liquids can go percolate through these solid particles, that the coke particles are there, remember. So it should be sufficiently distanced so that the nearby raceway should not interact. Okay, and the coke size, burden movement, coke size already we have told it should not be very high and it should not be very less. If it is a very fine coke size, then obviously it will affect your performance in terms of permeability. Fine cokes, if you have been packed in a bed, then the permeability will be very poor. So you need to have an optimum size of cokes so that the permeability will also be there and the raceway performance will also be better. And the blast modification, like the humidification is one there. Humidification means you are injecting some amount of moisture, H2O, along with your blast. Why are you injecting? To control the blast temperature. When you inject moisture, the temperature that what we talked about 2000 will get reduced because you are injecting H2O, and that H2O will crack there, and that cracking, H2O cracking is another endothermic reaction. So the raceway, the raft, adiabatic temperature, flame temperature will get reduced. Okay, it is just a data, theoretical data, maybe from the model. The residence time of for a coke particle in raceway is just 20 milliseconds. Then you can see what is the size of that coke particle, which is getting consumed completely in just a fraction of seconds, that it's a 20 milliseconds, okay? Unburned coal dust will be a problem, that I already told. If there are any unburned coal particle, if it is coming out from the raceway, which has not been properly burned, then it is a problem because it is going to deposit into the active coke zone. And that will again, it will create problem in liquid percolation. Okay, these are all some elastic profiles it is being given. And you can see here the temperature profiles. So I think raceway we have completed. Now let us come to this dead man coke zone. Dead man coke zone and the active coke zone, it is more or less same only. But dead man coke zone, the name comes because, you know, some part of accumulated coke in the hearth region, which is not taking part in the chemical reactions or in other way, which is obstructing the performance of the blast furnace, like that. Okay, basically the active coke, the coke zone, what we call that, the huge heap that coke is accumulated in the hearth region, from hearth region to the belly region, which is completely is called as dead man. And the part above or in parallel to raceway, we call it as an active coke zone because that is actively involved in some function. The one is a percolation and another is some chemical reactions. So there are some involvement of that. That coke zone is there, that coke material which is accumulated in that zone, belly region is there. So we call it as an active coke zone. Okay. Yeah, you can see it is a angle of repose of coke is 36 to 38. That's the way this heap will be forming. With that angle it form. This is called dead man. This is called dead man. And this part what we referring as an active, because this is active. The function is there. Here it is subjected to the process parameter and the operating parameter, whether it is involved in reaction or whether it is not involved in reactions. So that it's been called as a dead man coke. No way it can go out. It can only get consumed maybe this part of raceway. When you are injecting, the gases can sweep out some amount of particle from here and then which can involved in the reaction. It is dead. So that it is called dead man. It is there and it is not actively parting. It can only get consumed only by raceway here. Okay, and that is written very limited participation in chemical reaction because this has been formed by fine dust particles. Okay, not completely fine. Some amount of lumps will be there. Some amount of disintegrated coke particles are also there, and located from upper post to lower coke. That's what the total thing here it is. In general, you can refer everything is a dead man, but here since it is active, we have referred it as a separately active coke zone. Okay. And heat from raceway is very limited. That's I told. Only the gases, because the reduction mixture, gas mixture, basically it is passing from here. Okay. It is going upwards only. None of the gases are coming here, so that it can heat up some. This dead man, that is not taking place. So that's why it is getting very limited amount of heat from the raceway. Okay. And what way it is basically assisting, it is again, it is giving path for the liquids, deadman coke zone. One is, it is getting soaked completely of the liquids, whatever it is receiving from the top, it is getting soaked, and then it is leaving space to the liquids and some annular space between the particles, whatever it is present, through that the liquids are. This has to be another important function for this deadman, that has to be there. And liquids reside between pores of the coke. It is also happening. And final composition adjustment is happening here, because the liquids are here, coming and residing here, and the deadman is here. So the composition adjustment, the thermodynamic equilibrium that is coming into existence, carburation and reduction, any left out FeO, okay, those things. And coke size, it controls the coke size because it is getting consumed also here. And the blast modification, again, it changes the thing. Okay, there are different types of deadman. Again, see, the blast furnace, in terms of blast furnace, everything is already known after that dissection study by the Japanese, I told yesterday. But there are few things still it is mystery. Might is there, which is not being understood properly. The one is the deadman. Whether if the deadman is floating or whether the deadman is sitting, these two is still, because you know the density of the coke is what? It is lighter than hot metal, right? So it's supposed to float, right? But the perception is that it have a very strong foundation from the bottom of the heart, and it have a heap like structure, that is called sitting deadman. And there are some hypotheses, and also based on some operating parameters, sometimes it can float. It can float as the liquids are coming and getting accumulated in the heart, it will lift the deadman and then it will float. The possibility is there, but we do not know what is happening at what point of time. And the clean deadman and the dirty deadman. This is categorized based on the performance or the function of the deadman. As I already told, if these functions are happening, then it is a clean deadman. It's very simple. Whatever the functions I told, it should provide path, it should heat up, it should the composition adjustment between the hot metal and the hot metal slag and the coke. If all these things are happening, then it is a clean deadman. If these things are not happening, then it is a dirty deadman. Means the dirty deadmans will not involve in chemical reaction. Okay, it will not allow the liquids to percolate inside the heap. In that way, what will happen? The liquids will only reside on the surface, surround the heap, the coke heap. The liquids will be residing until the tap hole is opened. Okay. In that case, what it will happen? There cannot be a sufficient carburetion. The hot metal will end up with low amount of carbon. These are all the indications that deadman is dirty. Okay? That's what given. There can be a decrease in carbon in the hot metal, and the FeO, the left out FeO, has to be reduced at most in the final stage in the deadman. If that is not happening, then it is a dirty deadman, and the liquid level rises, as I already told. The liquid level rises in the sense the volume is more occupied by the deadman, and the liquids are not means the level of the liquid rises because there is no space to accumulate. And increase in hot metal and the wall temperature, and decrease in hot bottom temperature. These are all the indications that the deadman is dirty. Like this, the liquids are only staying here. Okay, and the liquid level will increase, and it will affect the peer performance. Okay, this is not a good sign. And this will create a preferential flow of liquids close to the periphery, and it will create more erosion on the refractories because it is interacting more with the refractories rather than the other part of the heart and the liquid level. These are all the consequences. Okay, the reason for the dirty deadman zone is a poor coke strength. It leads to very fine coke particle, which is getting deposited on the heart and which is not allowing the hot metal to pass through the heap. So the basic problem here is coke strength, and the second is the lower temperature of deadman zone. If the deadman zone is not receiving sufficient temperature, and as we already told, this is the only part where it can receive temperature. If that is not receiving properly due to some change in the tear performance, then it will turns to be a dirty deadman. Why? When the temperature is low, you can expect whatever the slag and metal already inside the dead man will get frozen. It might have crossed the liquidus point, means that solidification start point due to lowering of temperature. So it might have frozen and it would have created chilled heart condition. Okay, these are the prime reasons that a dead man can be a dirty dead man. Okay. I think this is another just a pictorial view where you can see. Okay, that way the dripping is coming, the liquid is coming from the top, and the liquid level in the heart rises, and when it rises, and then operator will get indication, so then the tap hole will be open and liquids will be removed. Okay, so till here today's lecture is over. So this is the part I expected to cover today. The reactions, the most important reaction, that is the silicon reaction and the sulfur reaction, that will be discussed in the next class. I think if you have any doubts, you can ask here. Let me also see my notes once. If any points missed out, then I will just quickly I will give it to you. Yeah, what is your doubt? I think you can switch on your microphone and then you can also speak, so that others can all can be audible.
Now you told that two years on pushes away the burden. And why don't it pushes the liquid, and how the liquid drips into the heart zone?
Yeah, the liquids are basically dripping only. The zone what we have discussed today, that been completely packed with the solid particles, coke particles, and the liquids are basically dripping. There are chances that liquids can drip through the two-year zone also. Okay, these chances are there, but there are no any bulk liquid is available where this tuer can push it. Okay, that one thing is there. It pushes the liquid the heart level. If the heart level is very high, then it can little bit push the liquid deeper into the heart. That is possible. It can push anything, everything, whatever available in front of the tuer zone when the blast you are injecting. And 90% and 90 to 95% what you have in front of the tuer is nothing but the solid coke, and the liquids are dripping, so it is pushing. Okay, it can also push when the level is very high, then it can just push in the bottom, that this part it can push. Okay, but one small change is that tuers are not uprighted like this fashion. It is not fixed like this. It is actually fixed like this to some extent. Okay, the angles are not as per actual. So just for understanding only, we have given these angles, but it is just slightly like this only it is. Yeah, so you are clear? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Any other doubts? See, one thing I forgot to say, whatever these liquids are dripping here, you are seeing now, I think these liquids, basically, as I already told, this is the part where it is oxidizing, and this is the part where it is reducing. Okay, so whenever the liquid passes through this reducing zone, it is good. The left out iron oxide will get reduced, and the iron, metallic iron, molten iron will form, and then it will accumulated in the heart. But when the liquid is passing through the oxidizing zone, what you can expect? The molten iron would get oxidized. The FeO will form. Okay. So these are all the complex phenomena that is happening. So the metal, ultimately you have formed molten metal here, iron molten liquid you have formed here, but also it can experience some oxidation and some secondary FeO formation because of the liquids that can pass through the oxidizing zone of 2S. It is also possible. I think this I have missed during explanation.
Yeah, I have one doubt now. The Deadman Cove zone is extended till the last portion of the
Deadman Cove zone? I am not able to hear you properly.
Deadman Cove zone vandu earthoda kadasi portion. Deadman Cove zone vandu earthoda kadasi portion varaikum extend a irukumana?
Yeah, that is the perception. That's what we are referring as a sitting Deadman. Okay. It have its foundation like in the bottom of the hearth. So that it been called as sitting Deadman.
Then the furnace lining ipa repair pannumbod blast furnace repair pannumbod and the region of coke vandu consume aayirukadhu so adu vandu choke aga vaipillaya and edathiley settle aga vaipillaya na
yeah for the furnace repair when they do furnace repair I also think that they will remove all these things means that okay. It's not an intermediate repair if they want to shut down completely and then want to complete reviving the furnace then they have to clear all these things. It will not choke okay. because the liquids, you know, the liquids will get flow out from through the tap hole. Those are all you may be knowing that these tap holes are not present in the extreme bottom of hearth. It is basically in certain height it is there. It is intentionally kept at a certain height so that some liquids will always remain in the hearth to provide the thermal support for the hearth. If you remove all the liquids from the hearth by keeping the tap hole in the utmost bottom of the furnace or the hearth, the liquids will completely get depleted and the temperature will drop. So intentionally the tap hole is kept at certain height above the hearth level, so a part of liquid only every time it will get removed. Okay, so that's the reason this Deadman Cove will not come or play in, come to a role where it can choke the tap hole. That sort of business it will not, and obviously it cannot choke 2S because 2S is 2S already I told the velocity of the blast that is coming is huge. It cannot choke 2S. It whatever everything is present in front of 2S that will be pushed away. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Any other doubts are there? Vengadeshan? Vengadesh? Anyway, I think he's offline. Okay. So we can close today's lecture. Okay, maybe in the next lecture we will see this transfer reactions, particularly silicon and sulfur. Those two are most important. Rest all others are getting completely reduced and they are joining the metal phase. These two only have some competition whether where they need to go, and there is a lot of demand from steel makers side that sulfur has to be this much level, silicon has to be this much level. So the primary control of quality of hot metal rely on control on this silicon and the sulfur transfer. Let us see what is the mechanism and how the sulfur and the silicon is moving to slag and metal appropriately. That we will see in the next lecture. Okay. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, Ashok Anna, for giving a physical feeling of blast furnace.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Na.
Yes.
Still, we'll go ahead our next lectures. Thank you all guys for joining.
Yeah. Thank you.
We will wind up.
Yes.
Thank you.